Thanks for joining us on the special program on Budget 2014, What Corporate India Wants from the Finance Minister. I'm joined by India's top corporate leader, Seshagiri Rao, Joint MD and Group CFO, JSW, Arun Nanda, Chairman of Mahindra Holidays, Didi Rati, Director at Aditya Birla Group, and Sumant Sinha, Chairman and CEO at ReNew. Gentlemen, many thanks for joining us on Bloomberg.
Pleasure.
Mr. Nanda, let me begin by asking you about what do you expect this budget to be? Will this budget be incremental in nature? Are you expecting big bang reforms to be announced?
I don't think the budget will carry big bag reform because there is a lot to be done. I'm hoping that he will give a roadmap as to what he is going to do. But if we are expecting something very significant, I don't think with the problem that we are in, you're not going to see anything significant happening this year.
Sure.
What we would like to see is some of the irritants being removed, simplification of the tax laws,
right,
especially the indirect tax. You know, people all the time talk of DTC.
Sure.
The excise has become an act which is more governed by notification than by the statute.
Sure.
And the only people who benefit are my friends in the legal firms.
Sure.
So I think on that, on the subsidies, he started already showing that he is going after the subsidies he's going to make.
Sure.
I think both on the fiscal deficit side and on giving boost to the economy,
right,
I think if he lays down a roadmap, it will do a lot of good to bring the feel-good factor so that my friends on my left, when they sit in their boardrooms, they will plan to incur larger capital expenditure and create employment.
Sure.
That's what I'm hoping for.
Mr. Rati, do you think this will be a statement by this government that can perhaps say, look, we are about going to fix the problems or the mistakes of the past? Or do you think this is going to be a roadmap for the future?
Well, I don't know how to distinguish between the two.
Sure.
It would be not prudent to say that there has been no mistakes in the
right
past. See, let me start from the beginning. First positive point this government has is the government with a very clear mandate. Secondly, it has already announced a lot of steps which it wants to take, it proposes to take. I would endorse what Mr. Nanda says. The priority should be, A, bring back the governance issues. You know, governance
right
is key to everything, whether it impacts the thing directly or indirectly.
Sure.
Secondly, the policy measures. I think a lot of policy measures have been announced. And I look forward to the execution.
Right.
The key always lies in execution, not on the announcement.
Sure.
The third thing I'll look to is kickstart the investment cycle.
Sure.
You see signs of that. Of course, there are unexpected challenges which this government would have to face recently. A, poor monsoon. B, the Iraq situation which was not anticipated and
right
things like that. There are a lot to be done. There are a lot of problems.
Sure.
I think it will be adequate if you get a clear roadmap as to what is going to be done in what phase of time. And my focus will be that they should announce a lot of administrative reforms.
Sure. I'll come to that in just a moment. But the broad point of the fisc that Mr. Nanda was alluding to as well, do you think, Mr. Rao, on the fiscal consolidation, that you will see some bold measures, attack on subsidies, roll back some the unproductive NREGA expenses, make it a little more productive? Do you see that happening?
No, fiscal prudence is very much essential, which the industry also is expecting in the budget to come. So fiscal prudence, not by increasing the taxes, but by disinvestment. That is the focus I think this budget would bring, in my view. That is the roadmap which the industry is eagerly waiting for. So with that, both the things can be balanced.
Sure.
One is achieving growth, and at the same time, the fiscal prudence will come in. And the way they have been articulating that the manufacturing is very, very important, that should be given priority. So in order to ensure that manufacturing will get its proper place in our overall economy,
sure,
then whatever irritants, as Mr. Nanda has explained, those irritants removal to ensure that investment cycle will come back. And the manufacturing will revive in India. I think those steps, those roadmaps are very important element in the budget.
Sumant, what do you feel? Do you think this is going to be a budget that's going to be, you know, not about hitting large sixes, but about taking those important singles and two runs?
You know, a couple of things, Harsha. The issue right now is that the government has been making very commonsensical statements. I think they're focused on increasing the ease of doing business. They are focused on trying to debottleneck critical sectoral problems, whether it's in infrastructure, whether it is in, let's say, the supply chain side, as far as APMC is concerned. And they have made some prudent noises around trying to correct fiscal issues with, you know, the rail fare hike and so on. At the same time, they've also deferred the gas price hike. So I think the way this government is probably going to approach this issue right now is that this is just the first in a long series of budgets. You know, they are looking at perhaps the first 2 or 3 years to repair the economy and then really grow. But I think even in that repair phase, they will certainly try to show a very different stance from the previous government.
Sure.
And show that they mean business. And that is where I think a lot of this government's credibility will be tested in this particular budget, which is really around the kind of statements that that Finance Minister Jaitley makes in the budget. Does he lay out any sort of a longer term roadmap? Does he make a more formal announcement of the government's, let's say, more pro-business stance?
Hmm.
Does he therefore also make, you know, give sops to things like retrospective taxation and make some statements around those things?
Sure.
So, you know, do they make any statements that further reinforce and re-enhance the general positive sentiment that all of us have?
Sure.
I think on the fiscal question, they'll probably be prudent.
Right.
I think they'll try to change the quality of the fiscal deficit from, you know, moving it more towards the capital side than the revenue side.
Sure.
So they'll try to make those adjustments. But given the limited room for maneuver, it's probably going to be more at the edges. And so therefore, the real takeaway from this budget is likely to be more around the statements that are made and the long-term roadmap that they lay out.
It's the commentary more than the individual measures. Ms. Nanda, you know, you spoke about the investment cycle. What do you think needs to be done to kickstart the investment cycle? Are you expecting investment-linked incentives to be announced?
No, I'm not expecting that. I think what the industry really needs is, to borrow from Mr. Rathi's phrase, a good governance. But I think we also have had too many issues which have delayed projects. You know, whether it is land acquisition, whether it is other infrastructure issues, mining, you know, the environmental sort of issues.
Sure.
I think some sort of direction there, which need not come through the budget, which is actually
correct.
But where the other thing, which again will not come from the budget or from the government, is interest.
Right.
Now, if he can check the inflation, if he can bring in, as they are talking of bringing the measures, if he can bring the inflation down, if he brings up the limit for the lower category to whatever, whether it's 5 lakhs or whatever it is, I think that segment has really been worst hit.
Right.
From an industry perspective, I think we need three things. We need a market. And fundamentally, the market exists. I think there may be little glitches here and there because of the high interest rates or things like that. Fundamentally, the market still exists.
Sure.
We need to bring a feel-good factor into the market. The second is a level playing ground with no unnecessary roadblocks of projects getting stuck for 3 years with environmental ministries or that sort of a thing.
Sure.
Now that's, and he's talked of roads, he's, you know, which is, he talked of supply chain. You know, we need to get our goods and components to the plant and goods to the customer.
Correct.
So I think those are things which are going to really help. Third is interest factor. Interest, we've seen the governor take very strong position, and he is right in his own way. I don't subscribe, because my view is that some amount of inflation is good in a growing economy.
Sure.
But I'm not a macroeconomist, so I don't want to say. But we need three things. And the first two are definitely in the control of the government. Good governance, so that things happen, and making the feel-good factor come into the market. Stock market is an indication of feel-good factor coming into the market.
Absolutely.
So I think these are the things which we'll need. And if some of these things come in the budget, it's the mood of the budget. It's not what really happens. It's
right.
The mood in, and it's the government's forward thinking which will lead to more sanctions of capital expenditure in the budget, in the forms.
Sure. Mr. Rathi, you know, the challenges that most people talk about, especially in the infrastructure space, power plants need fuel, highways are still being stuck and they're still not being completed. Will this budget therefore be largely about unclogging those pipes?
Well, theoretically and really speaking, it should be. Because if you want to kickstart the economy, you have to spend on infrastructure.
Right.
I think I'll never be tired of saying that biggest bottleneck in our industry is infrastructure.
Right.
You see, the cost of infrastructure, we should be borne by the government. In many of the projects, we bear that. Now, for example, you know, if I put a cement plant, I can't think of a cement plant without putting a captive power plant. Now, captive power plants are expensive. If you look at the commercial plants, you know, we go by 50 megawatt, all this.
Sure.
And it puts additional burden on us. So I think infrastructure can never be ignored.
Right.
the NF comparisons, I think if we compare with China, we'll be nowhere, standing nowhere. So government must continue to spend on infrastructure. It should divide what infrastructure they are going to do on their own, what they will do with the public-private partnership, and what the private sector will develop itself. So there is no escape from spending on infrastructure.
And you expect some sort of a large investment to be announced?
I do think so, and there are resources which can be generated without levying the taxes and without fueling the inflation.
Mr. Rao, you know, Mr. Nandam made the point about inflation as well. The cost of capital is something that most in corporate India have been saying has been high, and we need some sort of a trigger. With inflation reigning high, are you anticipating if the government takes some action that the Reserve Bank of India's hand will be forced to cut rates?
No, inflation is majorly contributed by food and fuel.
Right.
They are the major...
and they are taking steps.
Yeah, they are taking steps. So inflation, in my view, over a period of time, not immediately, in the next 6 months to 1 year, inflation will come under control, notwithstanding that the monsoon is not favorable. Because of a large amount of food grains which we have in our kitty, if they can be released in a proper and appropriate manner, I think food inflation can be addressed, but not the fuel inflation. So assuming that the Iraq problem will get resolved, and if we can address that, then that also, if it comes under control, there is a possibility, high probability of inflation coming down and interest rates coming down. That can be worked out.
Sumant, you know, we're talking at a time when inflation continues to reign high. Are we going to be in this high inflation zone and high cost of capital? Is it here to stay?
Well, I certainly hope not, Harsha, because that would be a real disaster, to be honest. You know, already one of the biggest reasons why there are no new projects getting done, apart from all the sectoral problems and clearances and so on, is the fact that our cost of capital is very high. You want to get a new project financed, it costs you 13-14% in debt terms. And then what that does is it also pushes up return to equity expectations up to 20-22%. And so therefore, you know, it becomes very hard to get any new projects off the ground. Now, we have to move the cost of capital, borrowing costs, down to sub 10% for sure. That way, cost of equity will also go down. And that's when you really start seeing a lot of investments beginning to happen. I think today the cost of capital is just very high. And also for consumers, you know, that dampens demand from a consumer standpoint as well, because their borrowing costs, mortgage costs, or, you know, buying cars costs, durables, financing costs, etc., everything goes through the roof. So this is one penalty that the entire economic system is paying. And I do agree with Arun that we have to find some way of bringing it down. And I think certainly food inflation, as Mr. Rao said, can be addressed. On fuel, I think the government may have to provide some extra subsidy for some longer period of time, just to keep inflation on a more managed trajectory. Of course, they'll have to increase prices at some point. That's a given. And I think that the RBI has to, at some level, play ball, because, you know, we can't. I understand what Raghunam Rajan says, which is that inflation ultimately sort of hits everything and sort of causes growth to be dampened in the longer term. But we need growth in the short term, and let the longer term, you know, have more faith in the longer term, and let the longer term take care of itself. If we don't have a short term, the long term certainly is not going to be there.
I'm going to take a break on that. When we come back, I want to shift focus and talk about taxation, DTC, GST. Will it finally happen? We are watching this special program on Budget 2014. Welcome back. You're watching this special program on Budget 2014. We're discussing what corporate India wants from the finance minister this time around. Mr. Nanda, I want to talk really about, you know, the biggest bone of contention since the last couple of years has been on taxation and the concept of retrospectivity. Do you think this government, on the floor of the parliament, this finance minister, will take the opportunity to say, principally, this is wrong and we're not going to do this anymore?
I think he will, because Mr. Modi has a perception of being industry friendly. I think he's seen the world, and I think he will do things which will bring more stability in the economy, which will attract. He understands FDI. He's, you know, you talked of infrastructure. I believe he's been to China four times already to see what infrastructure is. So if he's going to do that, look, if I can step back, as Mr. Rathi correctly said, that we need to set the infrastructure right. That's our biggest problem.
Sure.
And Sumant talked about the cost of capital. Cost of capital, let's keep it aside. Now, for infrastructure, either it has to come from FDI or it has come to come from disinvestment.
Right.
You cannot keep on increasing the fiscal deficit and leads to that.
Sure.
So, he has to bring FDI, and if you have to bring FDI into the system, you have to make it attractive for the people to come.
Sure.
And he understands it, and these are things you will see in the budget for sure.
So you're saying a clean, fair, transparent tax regime is necessary.
Is absolutely necessary, and it should also, as Rathiji said, it should also play out what the future will look like. Because if I am a private equity investor or a foreign investor, I don't want to know what the law today is.
Correct.
I want to know at the time of my exit what it is going to be.
Right. I take your point. Mr. Rathi, you know, the point of debate has been, and you've said this before in the past, on the direct taxes code. We had the Commerce Minister Nirmala Sitharaman talking to us, and where she said she's received inputs from industry which have not been very favorable towards DTC at all. Is DTC over?
See, I don't know how many buyers I'll find to my view. According to me, DTC need to be given a very decent burial. What is that you are trying to achieve through DTC which you cannot achieve through
the existing
amendment
law
to the tax laws?
Yeah.
Okay, now let me take the very realistic example. We have the Companies Act 2013 on board for a few days. We have the rules made there under, and every time we are retreating, so we don't know what is the law I'm going to implement.
Sure.
I'm sure all of us will have a nightmare if you go into the every,
and then there's a SEBI circular which says contrary, different.
So you, I have to every time run to Mr. Nanda to seek his advice. The point remains is that do not make new laws. You don't have much of experience. Our experience of Companies Act is not at all a very happy one.
Even with Companies Act.
Yeah, very. You see the 2013.
Sure.
How does it do it? So, very same thing could be achieved by modifying the existing law. Let also not forget, we have 2 lakh cases pending.
Sure.
Overall. 2 crore cases pending, of which sizable amount is tax laws, and which is government versus government.
Sure.
So, now you know, when you have a established act,
right,
you have so much of litigation. What happens when you put a new law in force? So I rewrite the history. It takes me 25 years to resolve one single case.
Right.
So really, if I start a case, I'm not going to resolve that. My successor will.
That's hitting the nail on the head, Mr. Rao. A large part of the last 4 years, we have seen corporate India in litigation with the government in some form or the other. What do you think needs to be done to bring back confidence and say, look, we're not going to be, this is, the tax regime is not going to be adversarial. What can be done in that? What needs to be, what kind of message can the government say through the budget?
No, I think we have to strengthen the mechanism of advance ruling and also the safe harbor rules and also the empowering the income tax department in a way that they will not unnecessarily go for appeals for a case where it is not strong enough.
Sure.
So I think these are the areas where they need to work upon. For instance, today a case which has been filed and they lost the case, and even commissioner appeal will go for an appeal there.
Sure.
Or commissioner will go for an appeal, even though he feels that it is not a strong case. But because they are more of revenue oriented. So that is also another problem which we are seeing as far as the department is concerned. So instead of revenue orientation, if they say it is a orientation towards the people who are really paying the taxes, if that type of mindset comes in the income tax department, that will solve a lot of litigations which are unnecessarily being fought by the department today.
Sure.
I just want to add something to what Mr. Subbarao said, Shashagar Rao said. See, one is this mindset. We suddenly find on 15th of December, lots of demand, especially in indirect taxes, coming because people are trying to meet their targets.
Right.
So even if you don't make them SSE friendly, make them feel that they are quasi-judicial people who have to do justice.
Sure.
I'm not saying be partisan to us or be partisan to that. And the second is that I do find sometimes honest officers very find it difficult to take decisions, tough decisions, because they don't know what their senior is going to do and what, you know, their file will be opened up.
Sure.
I think you have to give them confidence that if you take a judgment in true spirit, you'll be supported on that decision.
So, at the end of the day, it boils down to the concept of governance,
saying,
right?
Yeah. So, I'm saying that it goes to governance, and they should feel that they are neither tax collecting authority, nor are they favoring anybody. They are quasi-judicial people. At least at the ITAT and commissioner and the appellate level, they should think like quasi-judicial, because the appellate authorities think like tax revenue collectors.
Sure. Even ITA should consider that.
Sure.
I'll come after Sumant.
Sure. I have one other point that I want to ask you. Coming on this point about litigation and how this government can communicate a message that can restore confidence. Second, I want to ask all of you about MAT. There's widespread expectation that MAT is likely to be reduced. Sumant, what do you think?
I don't know, to be honest with you. I haven't heard anything in that regard. I'd be delighted if MAT does get reduced, actually.
Sure.
But I haven't really heard anything about that. And given this government's fiscal constraints, I would be a little bit surprised if it does do it.
Sure. On the issue of litigation, Sumant?
No, I think this government has made its position very clear, and I think it will continue to do so through statements of various ministers. They are supportive of business. That's, I think, a very fundamental change from the previous government, where there was a lot of mutual hostility and suspicion that had developed over time. This government is coming with a clean slate. As Arun said earlier, Mr. Modi is very business friendly. He understands business. And therefore, I think they are really viewing themselves as being facilitators. I think on retrospective taxation, they will probably go back and make a very assertive statement saying that they will not do so, they will not make any retrospective changes, that it will happen only in so-called very sort of rarest of the rare cases. So I think they'll make whatever sounds are required or that the corporate sector wants to hear in terms of making sure there's a stable tax regime, and they will try, as I said earlier, to be oriented towards ease of doing business and being supportive of businesses in whatever the issues might be, and taxation certainly is one of them.
Sure. I have my last round of questioning, gentlemen, and Sumant, I'll perhaps start with you. GST, this government has the political mandate and perhaps the will to implement it. Will GST finally see the light of day? Will we at least see a realistic time frame being announced?
I think so. I think that this government has already made positive statements, the finance minister has, about GST. I think, they will probably do one further round of consultations with states to make sure that there aren't any issues, and that they'll get them on board. And I think once that happens, in either 2015 or 2016, you'll probably see an implementation of GST. I think this government is clearly behind it. And as I said, it goes with the theme of trying to simplify, doing business in India. So I think certainly they will go for it.
Mr. Rao?
Seeing the progress which has been made in the GST so far, I think it is a long way from now. Even government is committed to that. Because the revenue neutral rate itself is not agreed upon between the states and the center in order to ensure that there is no loss of revenue to the states. So states have to agree first that they will not be at a loss by going ahead with the GST.
Sure.
In addition to that, the design itself, the design, what are the items that will be covered finally, what are the taxes that get subsumed into this? The design itself is not very clear. So the purpose of GST is all the taxes will get subsumed into that, either state level or central level.
Sure.
Now the most of the taxes, now again the debate has started that the tax on alcohol will not be included, tobacco will not be included, or the octroi is not included, entry tax is not included. That means so many taxes are getting again excluded from the GST purview. So the design itself, there is a problem. So that has to be debated and properly designed. Otherwise, even if we implement, we may not get the desired results.
So you're in effect saying further delay.
Further delay can happen. Constitutional amendment is required.
Sure.
So that also requires a lot of support from the state, Rajya Sabha and Parliament.
Mr. Rati?
I think you said whether we need GST or not. I think you do need GST.
Sure.
But the basic point, as I pointed out, is that look, you cannot measure. You want to rationalize something.
Sure.
Now you can't measure it whether I'll gain or lose out of this. So either you lose the basic character of rationalization. So I think GST, I don't think I can disagree with him that perhaps it will take longer than what we all was think so, but sooner it is than better it is for the growth of the business, it will solve a number of problems.
Last word with you, Mr. Nanda, both on GST and any other wish list.
See, on the GST, I agree with what has been said, that's needed, and it's not going to happen in a reason, but I have a third dimension to it, which is of bad governance or corruption, what you will call it.
Sure.
Because my personal feeling is OCTRA has not been abolished because that's the domain for the municipal corporators to make money.
Right.
So it's become a fiefdom issue rather than a policy issue. And I think somewhere if we get good governance and people don't see this as sources to make money for themselves, it will become easier to do that.
Sure.
So you will have to address the governance issue first.
We'll have to leave it there. I've completely run out of time. Many thanks, Anit, for joining us with your perspective. Thanks, Sumant, as well. Well, let's wait and watch what the finance minister will do on the 10th of July on Budget 2014. If you have been, thank you so much for watching. We'll be right back.